This is Jack Murr for BBTV. So we're joined here today by Dennis Hobson, a stalwart face of British boxing promotion and management. He's been behind the likes of Clinton Woods, Ricky Hatton, David Hay and Carl Thompson. And he's been a feast on of amazing boxing nights, and he's going to do us one better, and he's going to put on a world first this weekend. So I believe it's called the Straightener in the Car Park now. That's what it's been settled on. So can you tell our fans just a bit about it, what's going to be occurring?
Well, if you want me to tell you about the idea, where it came from, Jackie.
Yeah, start with that.
My secretary, Michelle, who I call Miss Moneypenny, we're very close, and she said, I'm going to a drive-in during this lockdown. I went, drive-in cinema, yeah. And I thought, take some pictures, Michelle. So, why? I said, just take some pictures, a scan round. Anyway, I thought, why not replace the big screen by a big ring? And then it went from there. I've had all sorts of different ways, backwards and forwards, how we're going to plan it and set it out. I sent over from Exporter some see-through pods, which ended up malfunctioning and they haven't worked. But when you see the setup, We've got a load of cards, but we've got some VIP areas what we've dressed up. You've got Paul Civil at Televideos, who's going to make it special. The production is really going to push it out. And I've got my partner, Steve Crump, pulling all sorts of strings to make sure we get certain personalities there. His company's supported him financially as well. And you know, I've done some big shows, like you just said, Jack, in Vegas with Ricky and Clinton Woods and wherever. And I did a big show for, I got Jim McDonald on the world title shot in his hometown of Doncaster at the Chemo. But this is right up there. And this has really got my juices flowing again. And I get the big time feel again because we are making a statement. And I'm really excited, to be honest with you.
Absolutely, and with so many people, you know, not in stadiums, with only a select few at some of the big fights recently, only upwards of a few hundred people at some of the recent BT shows and stuff. It's a great way of getting people back in. So just can you give us a sort of an idea of how large this event is going to be and how many people are kind of allowed in?
Well, what we've done, Jack, is because, like you just alluded to, is that every time you put the news on, and I watch the news a lot, it's full of negativity, and we're living in a negative environment at the moment, aren't we? And I'm quite an upbeat person. Yeah, I've got numerous businesses, and you get problems as you can imagine. But I only let that word be mentioned once, and then I just wanted a solution, and that's what's happened in this case. And we, you know, I kept hearing about the behind closed doors. They're not the same, Jack. I don't know if you're a football fan, but I'm a big Sheffield Wednesday fan as well. And I watch a lot of football. It's not the same, pal, is it? It's definitely just not. And, you know, you get quality players, but there's nothing like having a crowd there. There's nothing like the controversy at football. I know the VAR and all that is taking it a little bit away, but that's another story. But it just shows how the fans, I think, have been undervalued. And so we look for a way to get fans in. Now, what we've had to do, we've just been given a car park at Sheffield Arena, thankfully, and Dominic Coles, who's the head of SIV events. So I've done a deal with them. We just want to rent a car park. We have actually had to build some sort of like stadium, if you like, on a car park. And that's what we've done. And I've pulled favours in from my dear friend Zach Rowland, whose family did the scaffolders, and they built all the column and all the canopies and the structure. They've been friends of my family for three generations. So I've got that much support from and you know what, sometimes local councils are. I've got great people in this, health and safety guys who's doing it for me, Guy Naylor and Pat Smith. The Boxing Board of Control, so supportive, because they can see we're trying to create something. It's a first. There's a bit of a blueprint. And hopefully, if this tier three and lockdown continues, which I hope it doesn't for long, because it's no good for anybody, but there's still an opportunity to put something like this together. And yeah, look, there's nothing like being a first at doing something, and you never get a second chance to be a first here. And we are doing it. That gives me a buzz. But at the same time, I've been wanting to get boxers out there because they've been sat on their hands, and it's depressing. You know, there's a lot of people having mental health problems, and I get it, because as an entrepreneur, if you like, you get all sorts of demons. When I'm sat still, my brain wants to get into something.
Absolutely, yeah.
And my hands are tied. So, you know, it's got my juices flowing, like I say, and it's probably good for me, mental illness.
Absolutely. And I mean, the last I looked, you know, Sheffield was in tier three. So is that, you know, is it still going ahead as planned from last week? Have you had to make any sort of adaptations since that tier three announcement?
Well, when they were, I don't know if you remember the one of the, we've had that many different legislations that come out that if you had a decent meal, you could have some booze with it. Now they've knocked the booze off. So there's going to be people watching boxing having a Bovril and a cup of tea and a cup of coffee probably. But I'm sure, you know, there's some soft drinks and stuff like that. But do you know what, Jack? I think people so desperate to get out there and watch an event live and just be out there. And I think they will accept things like this, because I've been a boxing promoter 30 years near enough. And you could sometimes put the best fights on. But if they didn't get a drink or they didn't get served on time, they'd complain about that. And they could have seen Agler versus Tommy Hearns, the Sheffield public sometimes. But if they didn't get a proper drink, they'd had a bad night. So, yeah. But obviously the mentality's changed because of what we've all endured, but we've all been in it together. You know, it's one of them things. But there's light at the end of the tunnel. There's a vaccine coming out. So sooner rather than later, hopefully we're going to be able to get in some venues. But while we can't do, you've got to be a bit creative, like I have. And as soon as this fight's over, say 12 o'clock on Friday evening, or just 11:30, whatever it's going to be, I'll be thinking, how can I do something before we get some freedom and be able to win venues? So I'll be thinking about something, because that's how I am.
Absolutely. And the thing is, this is a blueprint now, as you pointed out earlier. This could just be a copy and paste job whenever we, you know, have another fight maybe on the cards. You could be starting something new here. I'm really excited for it, just to see how it plans out. And obviously for the fights, we've got some really interesting fights. So I believe that Tommy Frank has now landed on a sort of young prospect in Harvey Horn. Is that correct? That's still...
And I won't be able to pronounce the Mexican. I couldn't agree terms with his agents, Avion. And they might want to say it was me, but sometimes there's two ways to say no in boxing, right?
Sure.
You either ask for too much money or ask for unreasonable demands, and sometimes you're better off just saying, no, I don't want to fight. So I called the time on it, and we've gone from a very credible Mexican, the IBF, have sanctioned it for an intercontinental. The Mexican who fought, I forgot, you'll have to have a look at it, Jack, his name, who fought Sonny Edwards and went points with Sonny Edwards for an IBO title, IBF title. So is a credible, world-rated type of opponent, and we'll be using this fight as a yardstick, because I do believe Sonny Edwards, for all the mouthing he does and whatever, is world class. Now, I believe that Tommy is world class. So at some stage, I'd like to get that fight on, but there'll be only one kid who don't want to do that fight, and that'll be Sonny. He wanted to do it, a year or so ago. It wasn't right, and I wanted to make it a bigger fight. And we're going the right way to make a fight like that a bigger fight. If somebody like Sonny Edwards don't want to do it, also, well, whatever. You know, look how many kids have manoeuvred into world title shots. You know, your Stuart Halls, who were going nowhere, and people like, you know, Jamie McDonald were going nowhere till he come with me. And so if people like Sonny or Harvey they want to make demands, then we'll go in a different direction and we'll go after another world title, another version. So that's what we're doing with Tommy. He's a great kid. He's a great boxer. and he's a great kid outside the ring. He's got a great story to tell, and he's a great kid to work with.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, Glenn Rhodes is saying that Tommy, you know, he could be as good as Clinton Woods, and obviously Clinton Woods turned out to be one of your best. So, I mean, how do you see his career kind of moving on? And sorry, before I ask that question, have you got somebody fighting him then on Saturday? Have you got like a name?
Yeah, I'll send you the. I've got it on me. On,
it's
on
just
the
that it's that guy who fought Tony. That's no problem.
Yeah, he's. I've got. I'll send it. Yeah. I'll WhatsApp it you his name yeah. because my Spanish is not brilliant. That's apart right. from Una Sabir.
yeah, that's the main one.
So I'll WhatsApp you the new poster, Jay.
That's perfect.
Yeah, as regards Clinton, you know, honestly, it was a similar sort of thing because people were saying to me, Dennis, why are you putting your name and putting your efforts and your money and your time into Tommy Frank? What's he going to do? Exactly the same as Clinton Woods.
Yeah.
And I said, I think he's got something. And I get on great with Glenn and we work really well together anyway. So I look okay. And that's what I'm about. But as Tommy's developed, older, now we've started to wanting to get into the down to the nitty gritty and fight Cal Youssefs or Harvey Owens and whoever, undefeated kids, that's when all the knockers have started to go quiet because boxing, more than anything in life, is about timing. And I want to pick when the time's right, when we go off the leash and go and have a go at trying to win something meaningful. Well, we're doing it here. And the reason why we're not fighting Kyle is because, nobody's fault, but he got a virus, but that fight should have taken place two or three times before. Give him 3 days and they wanted to move the date. Now, I know his family very well. I got on really well with Kyle. I've worked with him before, but that didn't happen. And the reason why we hadn't had a British title fight, look, it's fake sometimes, isn't it? We didn't know this virus were going to take off again and the things were going to go up. But it would have taken place before the actual lockdown because I'd give him a couple of days. But boxing's like that sometimes. So we're on with the Mexican, there's a credible opponent. If Tommy comes through okay, he fights Cal Youssef in an old Sheffield undefeated British title fight. So we've got his next year more or less planned out, have we, with Tommy? So we've got some exciting stuff that we're going to unravel and roll out to you and other people in the media. And I think you'll all play a part and you'll love what we're trying to do. And this show on Friday night, it's making a statement for us that we are players in the promoting game. Yeah, I've done some big stuff in the past, but I think we're on the way. Well, I know that we're on the way back up. I don't necessarily want to compete with Eddie and Frank for the Tyson and Joshua kind of fights, mm-hmm. but we will be involved in some big fights, mark my words.
Yeah, absolutely. We're really excited. And the fact that you're putting your neck on the line for this one obviously just shows to your character and your team's character as well and your boxers as well. They're willing to get out there in a pretty hostile climate at the minute. So, absolutely hats off from everyone in the boxing community for that. Obviously, we've got Cash Ali fighting as well on Saturday. That's still going ahead. Yeah. And he's fighting, Phil Williams.
We've had to change his opponent. When okay. did you get that opponent? When was that opponent? We got another opponent, the fellow with Steve Goodwin. So we've had to chop and change with Cash. But Cash is just coming back. He had Corona about 3 months ago.
Right.
So we had to decide what kind of opponent we wanted to come back with. Now, the big fight that we're going to try and make happen is David Price again.
Okay,
I think
great.
There's a lot of unfinished business. There's a lot of controversy with that.
Yeah.
All the Scousers ate Cash. And Cash, he's up for anything. If we've got to go into Liverpool again and fight David Price, he wants to put the record straight. He did something that wasn't right, but he in his mind and training with my dear friend Richard Towers, we've got him mentally stronger and a lot stronger. And David Price is some unfinished business. He took his undefeated record by a disqualification. Mm. Cash wants to make the record straight, and we're happy to do that, and we want to promote that, and we will be making plans to make that happen. David Price, I signed him when he came out of the Olympics. I got on great with him and his family. He's a lovely fella. He's a name, but this is business, and there's some unfinished business with Cash. So that's the fight we're going to be looking at after this.
Absolutely. And, that fight was really intriguing because many people, you know, including myself, actually had Cash up on that fight. I appreciate you don't want to maybe rake up old graves, but what was actually, you know, was there things going on outside the ring with Cash at the time, which kind of motivated him?
motivated him to take a chunk. Yeah. Yeah. I think he was just hungry, but... I think his dad had passed so long ago before. And he said, Dennis, I weren't in the right place. And he says, but look, when it comes to fight business, my mind wasn't on it, but I just reverted back to kind. And obviously, I forgot where I was. I must have done that. I was in a boxing ring, but I'd just got in my mind I were in a fight. So I bit. And obviously, I shouldn't have done. And he's apologised, but he says, I've apologised too many times now. I'm not going to keep apologising. I want to get that fight back on. I've apologised. That's it. I've told you why I think I did it. And that's all I can say. So let's get on with business. Let's make it happen again. I believe I could have beat you. You think, you know, you could knock me out. Well, let's see. Let's see. Because that was...
sorry about that. It just cut out there the last 5 seconds. Sorry, I just missed that last bit. Apologies.
I'm just saying it wasn't finished in a satisfactory manner, Jack. So we've got to find a way to make it happen again. And let's see who is the real, who's the top man of those two. Because, you know, I think obviously, David Price has got world-class power. But his chin lets him down. But, you know, I mean, I've always rated David and I'd have loved to have worked with him, but I didn't have the TV backing me at the time. So we had to walk away. But I think I could have done a better job with David Price. But I would say that. But my concern now, and I think, could be the future, one of the future kids, and I'm talking about Cash being in that top 3 or 4 bracket in this country, who are world class. I think Cash can gate crash that. I think Cash can create, because I've seen him do things in that gym with Richard, what I haven't seen in many heavyweights. And he's just starting to get, I believe, that cockiness without it being arrogance, but he's just starting to believe in what he's capable of doing. And he's done plenty of sparring all over. Peter Fury, my dear friend Peter, and Yue, he's been over there sparring with Yue. They really rate Cash. Well, I think Yue, Cash will be in the mix, in the top 4 or 5 in this country. And that means they're going to be world-class because they're going to get world-class fights. So that's where I want to be with Cash Alley.
Awesome. And do you know, obviously, you know, getting David Price on your record, getting a win over him, if that were possible, that would really accelerate his career. Who would you be kind of lining up potentially for him after that, you know, if that fight was made and he got through it?
We'd look on the, depending which world body we went with, I'd be looking to get Cash in the top 10. So if we could get in the top 15 or one of the bodies, and then I'd be looking to get him in the top 10 and just plot his path that way, Jay. Get a bit more experience and I'd get it. And then I'd look to get him in a world title eliminator in the next 18 months. That's how fast we think we're going to go with him. And who knows, in the next 2 years' time, he could have fought for a world title, depending on who's there. And if the time's right and Cash fulfills his potential, we could have the first British Muslim heavyweight champion of the world. So, you know, that's what excites me as well.
Absolutely. And obviously, you know, you've had a career of, you know, outstanding highlights. This is going to be a career first. This is going to be a boxing first this weekend. You know, what, just, you know, as a sort of conversation as well, I mean, what has been sort of your main highlight in your career, if you could narrow it down to maybe one or two?
I think it's got to be Clinton Woods. I mean, he came into my gym, my dear friend Neil, who's not with us anymore, Neil Port, and he was 21 years old. He's got a pot belly. He was a plasterer's labourer. He hadn't fought from, say, about 14 years old, and he just come to keep fit, and he was so raw. But Neil did a great job with me, with him training. I used to help train him as well in the early days, and I used to spar with him sometimes. And then we got him to about 9-0, and I thought, well, Neil's working, I'm working, we've got to test him, see where we're at, see what progress we've made with him. So I sent him down to Howard Rainey, down at London, to train with Terry Dunstan, Cornelius Carr, Colin McMillan, Scrap Iron Rank, to test him. Now, he had a hard time there, but what it did, it took him out of his comfort zone, and it were all part of building the character and the makeup of Clinton Woods. So I could be here all night telling you somebody, Jack, about how Howard crashed the Roy Jones press conference, just threw him on the stage in Miami. Just to make the Roy Jones fight. But all those fights were all learning curves. Now, he could have fought, and then he drew with Glenn Johnson, and I could tell you how I manoeuvred that and helped make it for a vacant IBF world title. And then, obviously, the fourth time of asking, we won a world title. Just before that, my dear friend was killed in December, but we won the world title in March. So that was and Clinton wasn't the favourite. It was the undefeated Rico Hoy, who was supposed to be the next coming of Thomas Hearns. Well, Clinton bullied the bully that night. He was unbeatable that night. That was his best ever performance. And I think everything coming together, and with Neil passing and everything went to plan. There were no injuries, the sparring, everything. And not saying it was divine intervention, but I think he just got an extra spur because we just all come together. Neil had gone, and I think it was just an extra spur. We just got him over the winning line, and I got my first world champion. And he was like my little brother, pulling him through. And sometimes Clinton, he were hard work to promote because he wouldn't go out and be controversial, wouldn't slag anybody or whatever. So it was difficult to build his name. So we just had to do it, you know, make his fighting do his talking. But yeah, it were a great journey with Clinton, and that's probably my best ever moment. But then once you've tasted it, it's like a drug winning something that's bigger than that. You want it again. And fortunately, I've done it with Carl Thompson, with Jamie McDonald, with Stuart Hall. And so I've done, and obviously when I did, and that's what enabled me to get working with Ricky, because they'd seen what I'd done with Clinton, and they wanted to work me because they were leaving Frank. They were going to go with Barry Hearns, and they weren't really happy with the deal. They asked me what I thought. I said, well, let me see what I can do for you. Go on in, Dennis. I says, tell you what, just give me 48 hours and I'll make the fight that you need. And I got him an extra 300 grand for a fight than what Barry Hearns were going to give him. And I made the fight, and then I did obviously the three after. And then, you know, there was certain things, certain people in Ricky's camp weren't honourable, and they did the Mayweather fight behind my back, which wasn't agreed. But that's another story in itself. But Ricky, if you think of Ricky's most successful part of his career, it was with me. He won world titles every fight with me. 100%. So I did a great job. I mean, if you speak to Ricky, me and him's got a great rapport, and he loves our time what we spent together, because I wasn't just a promoter. I was like a pal as well. But I'd pull him up. I went to backslapper. I'd say, What do you think you're doing? Come here, what are you doing? All the kids go, Ricky, you're fantastic. I want your autograph. Let me have a photograph. Let me have a selfie. No. I go, come on, we're off. And I would like be like his pal who's putting him right, but at the same time, I'd have a laugh with him.
Yeah.
And that's how I've tried to be with most of the fighters who I've been involved with. I don't want to just sign fighters for them to be numbers, but I suppose as you get older and you get busier, I used to go in the ring just about in the corner with every fighter I work with. But, you know, as you get busy and get more successful, you can't, it's not possible with everyone. But I still love to get in the corner sometimes. I think I helped Jimmy McDonald achieve world championship because I used to mentor him a little bit as well. And I've had some great nights, and you know, Jimmy McDonald were another big night. But I love the Carl Thompson versus David A world title at Wembley Arena because I was promoting David A at the same time, and I got Adam Booth and David A saying, oh, you've got Carl Thompson, he's won a world title, we want to fight him, and you're our promoter and you're his promoter, you've got to make the fight. I went, yeah, I will do, but I don't think David's ready for Carl. He says, no, you've got to make that fight. I went, okay, I will do, because I'll enjoy watching it. I'm a boxing fan.
Yeah.
But as a businessman,
yeah,
not a good move.
I suppose that's a contradiction you just constantly have to deal with in your career, weighing up the fan and you.
Of course. And what happened? We all know what happened. We all live and learn. I mean, Adam's turned out to be a quality trainer. Yeah. But at that time, obviously, we're still learning. And he learned from that, which I would say were a mistake. I, in my wisdom, thought it were a wrong move. And it turned out to be so. But, you know, he moved on and look what he did after that, David, as well. So, fantastic what he did after that. But Carl Thompson, I love Carl. Because I got slated for bringing him back because he retired and said, he approached me. I fancy having another go. And, okay, let's see what we can do. And in a couple of matches up to that, it looked very ordinary. It looked ponderous. And then when he was getting beat by Sebastian Rothman, who was the IBO world champion at the time, I thought, oh no, what have I done? And then Carl, as he does, from nowhere, brought a leveler out and Sebastian Rothman's head were in the canvas, perked with his bum stuck in the air.
Bent over.
And that obviously... I mean, I've played football all my life. I've never jumped as high to head a ball. I jumped so high when he got the result and when he got the knockout. But it was, you know, vilified, you know, the decision I'd made. So, you know, the little moves. My dad was a compulsive gambler. I would have grown up to be the same because I raced grounds. I used to buy grounds from Ireland. And we raised grounds for all my young life. So I've still got a bit of gamble in me. And I think being an entrepreneur, you've got to have a bit of gamble and adventure in you. And I've got that. And I think that's the reason why I've probably been as successful in boxing. I've had plenty of knockbacks, by the way, Jack. You don't appreciate your wins unless you have a few losses as well. But I've had a few losses, but I've learned from them. They're not losses, they're learning experiences. And that's what I've done. But fortunately, I'm blessed that I've managed to develop and been involved with probably about five world champions. So I've had a great run, but I'm still hungry for more. And there's still a few more chapters in me.
Absolutely. I mean, I could sit here and pick your brain about all of your stories all night. Mm-hmm. But just to close this up, I mean, we've spoken about Cash Ali and Tommy Frank. Who else should we be looking out from your roster? And
we've got, Jack, we've got a great chief support. He's for a central area title. You've got John Fuchs, who's always worked with Glyn Rhodes all his career. Now, John Fuchs trains, I had a gym where he just runs. So he runs our gym now, John, and he's developing fighters himself. So he's got an Asian lad called Sufyan Ahmed, yeah. And Glenn's got a kid called Kane Salvin. So the fight's at Super Feather. They're both undefeated, and they're going to fight each other. So it's Glenn coming up against John and two Sheffield kids fighting each other. Now, what they've agreed to do, because I put this to them, you'll like this one. I said, right, would each of you, because they're both very confident, would you do a winner-takes-all fight? So I rings Glenn up. Yes.
Love it.
Ask John, would Suth fight winner-takes-all? Absolutely. So this is going to be for the central area, but a winner-takes-all fight. This will be. This might be the best fight of the night.
Love it. Yeah, that'll be a determined fight, I can imagine.
Absolutely. So there's a bit of spice. I mean, Kelly Maloney's there. She's bringing the Irish girl, Cathy, who we're hoping we can help go towards a world title, and we want to promote in Belfast with her.
Awesome.
So,
fantastic.
So that's one what's on the cards for us, and I'm hoping we can make that happen in the next 12 or 18 months as well. So we're making strides forward now at a pace. We've just got to get rid of this virus, get people in stadiums, and then we can get about our business properly.
Absolutely. Well, Dennis, no, I've thoroughly enjoyed chatting with you. Thank you so much for giving me the time to, you know, to ask you those questions. We can watch the fight then on, is it TalkSport?
No, Eurosport.
Eurosport.
It's on Eurosport. Yeah, and it'll be on from 8 p.m. on Friday, the 11th of December. But just the setup, I'll tell you this now, Jack. Eddie and Frank will be having a look how I do it.
Yeah, definitely. Oh yes, I know.
I hope they see burn the lips when they see it.
They're waiting for you to do it first, so they can just steal your blueprint.
Oh, I'm a guinea pig. Yeah, I'm a guinea pig.
Well, I wish you all the best with it. I'm sure it's going to go fantastic. I'll be tuning in to see the fights. So, all the best with it. And thanks very much for giving me your time.
You're welcome, Jake. You're a good guy, and it's a pleasure to meet you, pal.
Yeah, pleasure to meet you too. Thank you very much. All the best. Have a nice evening.
Speak to you soon, Jake.
Cheers. Thank you.
Bye. Bye.